Hey folks, it's Nick. I wanted to film a quick video today. We get asked a lot, leasing related questions. There seems to be still quite a bit of misinformation or misconceptions floating around. So what I wanted to do is cover one, two, three, four, maybe even five of the most common lease questions that I get on a weekly, daily, monthly basis. So let's just get started. Try and keep the video under 5 minutes. So here we go. So leasing versus financing, is there an objective benefit to leasing versus financing? So number one, yes and no, it really depends who you are. So I'll give you the perfect scenario. If you are looking to drive a car for only a few years and you like having the newest, the latest and greatest, leasing is obviously a little bit of a more shiny option and hidden benefit as well when you're leasing a car. Not many people know this. Obviously it's not something dealers go around saying, the time of purchase, but if anything were to happen to you when you're leasing that vehicle, like in terms of an accident or damage on the car, basically you're covered under insurance. If you were to get into an accident in a vehicle that you were financing, it's still under your name. When you go and decide to sell that car, the car proof is gonna be dirty and tainted for the rest of time, right? When you're leasing a car, you sign a contract with that manufacturer, that dealership, for a certain guaranteed residual amount, which is the amount that the car will be, once that lease is done, after a certain amount of kilometers. So, 20,000 kilometers a year at 5 years, this is a residual value. At the end of your lease, you hand in the keys and regardless of what happens, but that's just, one small point. I could go into a tangent, but not really advertised or talked about, but one of the huge benefits of leasing, if you get into an accident, you don't necessarily have to worry about what's gonna happen to the value of that car. Another point to the benefit of leasing is, of course, when you're in a car for only a couple of years, it gives you the ability to have a little bit more of a concrete strategy in terms of when the final point is, when you're going to get a new car. Now, I guess what I'm trying to say is for a life event, if you're a student, leasing is an awesome option. And the reason for that is you're probably going to be at a certain income level. You're probably going to be doing a consistent amount of driving to school every day or to that job. And there's not really many surprises in terms of life events. If you're an 18-year-old or 19-year-old looking for your first real new car, there's probably a pretty good chance if you're taking on a 5-year lease, which is most common, anywhere from 4 to 5 years, that not much in your life will have changed. Hopefully, knock on wood, in the sense that that vehicle will still be the perfect fit in terms of its size. You don't need any extra room for passengers or utilities that maybe you need in a bigger vehicle, or starting a new family or changing a job. So that's objective answer, subjective answer, depending on how you look at it. In certain scenarios, leasing is better. It's a little bit of shorter term commitment and there's less overall risk in the sense of the vehicle, the lifetime of that vehicle. Number two, a lot of customers ask, can I lease a used car? So in short, technically, let's just say for 2020, leasing a used car, we don't do that in 2020. And now there's a couple of reasons why. Number one, leasing a car back in the day, you probably could get an open-ended lease. And what that means is, instead of the vehicle being guaranteed at a certain amount, so let's just say, a closed-ended lease, I drive the car 20,000 kilometers a year, I guarantee that after 5 years, it'll have 100,000 kilometers, and this is probably what it's gonna be worth in the market at that time. You shake the dealer's hand, you sign the contract, you agree to that. A closed-ended lease is the exact same thing, but there's a little bit of a clause that says, hey, if the car is not worth that amount and it's worth less, you owe the difference. So let's just say that car was supposed to have been worth 10 grand. You drove it, and for whatever reason, maybe there's an issue with the car, the market price has gone down with just supply and demand, that car is only worth 5. Technically, on an open-end lease, you owe that $5,000 difference. Now, there are some clauses and special circumstances, but again, a closed-ended lease is generally on new cars. Pretty much, if somebody's telling you you can get an open lease on a used car, you don't really want to do that. Like, there's no point. It's always going to favor whoever's selling that because they can't predict the value of a used car. It's much, much easier to do it for a new car, specifically the kilometers, the way that that car will be traded. There's a lot of more that goes into the formula, of course, with the residual value and the calculations. And based on market share, the amount that will be coming back into the portfolio at that certain time of year, the seasonality to it, it's not just made up, right? Obviously, it's set to be competitive in the marketplace, but it's derived from a certain point of confidence, right? An open-ended lease is a lot more whimsical. Don't take the risk. If somebody tells you they can do an open lease on a used car in 2020, get back in your vehicle and don't do it. There's better options. Even if you can, there's better options. Obviously, we're talking about, you know, your everyday car. You know, God bless you if you're watching this and you're saying, you know what, the guy down the road told me I could get an open-ended lease on a Lamborghini. This video is not for you. Let's just say that. Okay, so you're driving a lease. Let's just say you're super happy. You're about to sign a contract. You have 20,000 kilometers a year and you're driving for 5 years. Okay, so 100,000 kilometers. Okay, fast forward 4 years or four and a half, maybe, you know, all the way up to four years and 11 months. And holy cow, I have 5,000 kilometers left. Really common question is, am I going to get the money back, right? So what happens with those extra 5,000 kilometers? Well, there's two scenarios. Most of the time, you're not going to get any kind of money back. You guaranteed the car at that value. It's just, you know, you can drive it to the exact amount. Or, you know, in the case of every lease has a kilometer overage charge, whether it's 8 to 16 cents. You know, so you drive 100 kilometers, you owe an extra $8. It's not the end of the world. It's better, in my opinion, to be a little bit under than over, but totally doesn't matter. As long as you understand how the kilometer overage works, it's in your contract. Definitely ask your sales consultant to explain that to you if you're unsure. But again, if you return your lease with extra kilometers, generally you're not going to see any kind of money back. If anything, if you're going to buy a car again from that dealer, maybe they're going to give you a little bit of a discount or incentive towards a new car, but they're not getting any money for it. It's just out of goodwill. So just to clear up that misconception. I guess we're on number four. So what happens when a lease is done? So obviously, okay, let's just say you're under kilometers, you're over. Great, you've solved that. You have two options. If you love the car, you can buy it out. So that means you say, hey, Mr. and Mrs. Dealership, whatever, I want to buy this car. You would then be able to purchase it for cash or finance through the dealership in-house with a bank rate or your own line of credit, however you want that arranged. Or option number two, you return it, here are the keys, and that's that. Again, pre-lease maturity, there's usually some kind of an inspection that's done, you know, whether it's 45 to 60 days out, just to make sure the car is in good shape. You know, the tires have tread on them. There's not crazy scratches. Generally, manufacturers are very fair with what they'll allow and consider a scratch. Like, I think for GM, anything under like an inch and a half, it's totally fine, right? Obviously, don't, you know, your car is keyed, that's a different story, but it usually is pretty lenient. So again, that will be given to you at the start of your lease, and you should always ask. A good dealership will always be able to provide you a lease maturity booklet or some kind of like a sample of what they receive from their parent manufacturer to help educate you and make sure that you're aware. But again, unless you've driven the car like crazy and through the woods and off road and all that, you shouldn't have any problems and there shouldn't be any surprises. A little bit over 5 minutes, but hopefully I can do a little bit more of these series over the next couple weeks to educate. If you guys have particular questions, maybe we can touch upon, would love to help out. And we look forward to seeing you in the next video. Take care.